me about the other fellas, little Sonny.
They're drinking that wine. Remember the schoolyard days?
Yeah. We had to take you home, man. You were proud of it,
oh,
man.
Oh, many a day. Lord have mercy.
Hey, but listen.
Yeah.
Remember when we used to run around there? Steal a hubcap off the car.
What you know? Talking about? Batteries?
We lucky we ain't get busted, man.
Listen.
Then I say, here comes the fun.
Hey, Mary, what corner was you from in the day?
That tender line.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
But dig this here.
Yeah.
Now, see, when all that gang war was going on, I'll tell you one thing I never forget.
And what's that?
See, when I got home, first thing I would hear is,
what?
Bill!
Yeah.
Where you been, boy?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
That's my mom.
I say, I was out with Sonny Bird and little Sonny.
Putting it all on us.
Yeah.
I had to put it on somebody.
Hey, Bill, what's your mama say?
She say, boy, now I'm going to tell you.
What?
You know you getting big now.
Yeah.
You got to watch the things that you doing out in that street.
Right.
And you go to jail.
Right.
And I'm going to tell you something, man. Mama wasn't wrong.
No.
But what about Pop?
Oh, we ain't talking about Pop.
No, man. Pop, well, he was all right.
Pop,
no,
Pop was a lot of bad
Pop
things.
Was hanging out, you know.
Yeah, hanging out.
I think Pop was making more wine than we used to. I know my pop did.
Yeah.
My pop hung right on with you, boy.
Yeah.
Stay out all night. Come on, clothes all wrinkled up, lip balls all on them.
Hey, Sonny. How about when your mommy cooked them good home cooked bits of baby?
Mr. Green?
Oh, man. Hey,
boy, your mama sure cooked her.
Greetings, hello, Akwaba, welcome. We hope all are well, and we're so glad that you joined us. Happy Mother's Day for all who celebrate. It is certainly a day, and we are glad you're here today. We hope you are achieving your highest level of mental, physical, and spiritual health, and we are so glad that you came to join us today on this first day of our new Facebook page for those that can view us there, Our Ancestors Voices. We're live there as well as Twitter and YouTube and Zoom. So today we're going to talk about African Liberation Day will change your life. And it's such an appropriate topic on Mother's Day because for African people who are scattered and suffering in over 120 countries around the world, our primary problem is our mother is under attack. And our mother is Africa, and she has been under attack for over 500 years. And so if we want a proper understanding of Mother's Day, of course we celebrate all of the human mothers or those who have mothered and played the capacity of mother in any way, shape, or form. But we have to start by looking at all of our mother, which is Mother Africa, and that she's under attack. And she needs us. So African Liberation Day is specifically a day to acknowledge all of our mother and the conditions that she's in, and recognize that until those conditions get better, none of our conditions will get better. So we are so glad you're here to participate in this for us. In the next couple of weeks, we're going to do programs with an African Liberation Day theme leading up to African Liberation Day week of May 25th, where here in the All African People's Revolutionary Party, we will host two events, which we'll talk about in the coming weeks. And just hopefully you can put that on your calendar and participate. It is an extremely important thing to participate in. So we're glad that you're here, and we give honor to the indigenous people of the Western Hemisphere. They are the rightful caretakers of this land, and we acknowledge that this is their land. It does not belong to us. We were kidnapped and forced to come here, and we are trying to redeem our mother Africa. And we also, of course, obviously give respect and honor to our African ancestors who gave us the platform to engage this fight for our dignity and our forward progress. So we are so thankful and so humbled to be able to continue in their enormous footsteps. So we're glad that you're here, and we think you'll find this program beneficial in terms of not only understanding the work of the All African People's Revolutionary Party, but understanding the concept of Pan-Africanism and where Pan-Africanism fits in the worldwide struggle for justice and forward human progress. So introductions, our ancestors' voices, as always, is sponsored by the All African People's Revolutionary Party, the APRP. Each week, we have this broadcast, and the APRP is a revolutionary, independent, mass Pan-African political party that is based in Africa. And our objective is Pan-Africanism. Pan-Africanism, which we define correctly as one unified socialist Africa. One unified socialist Africa. And our work to achieve Pan-Africanism culminates from the reality I mentioned when we first started today, that we believe and are convinced that until Africa is free, our mother Africa is free, united, and socialist, that no African anywhere on earth will know stability. So that's why that's our objective. That's what we're fighting for. Kwame Nkrumah outlined the strategy, which we'll talk about a little bit in today and the coming weeks in the Handbook of Revolutionary Warfare. You see on the opposite page. And Our Ancestors' Voices is a program that's hosted each week by myself and my daughter. My name is Ajamu, her name is Shakura. And we are gonna go ahead and get this topic started. And I'll start it by turning it over to Shakura.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that, Conrad. Yes, yes, greetings everyone. So again, we are so excited to talk to you today about the All African People's Revolutionary Party and one of our major events that we celebrate annually. One of the main reasons why I have come to love wearing white, I must say, is because of African Liberation Day. And so we start off by highlighting that we understand that Africa was under attack for a very long time, and it was actually planned out how people would consider themselves thieves in terms of stealing resources from Africa, stealing human people from Africa, and what that looked like. So if you haven't done your research, then you don't understand that colonizing Africa was a strategic plan that was created at the Berlin Conference, which convened in Germany in 1884. And literally, when I say strategic, I meant you had people from Portugal, you had people from Britain, you had people from Russia and parts of Germany. And they sat at this conference and said, well, you know, you could take Azania and let's rename it to South Africa. And hey, why don't you take Ghana and Burkina Faso, because they should speak French there. So why don't you all go there and make them learn how to speak French and take over everything? Oh, but you know what? I want them to speak Portuguese at this part. So I'm going to take this part of Africa. And that's literally how that became what it is. It's very, very important that we understand that, because this is why when you go to Africa, if you go to Ghana, you're able to speak English because the British colonized them and took over. This is also why if you go to Senegal, then you need to learn how to speak French, because they don't speak English and French. They speak French. They don't speak English and French. I'm exhausted. Sorry. They don't speak English in Senegal because they speak French. Thank you, y'all. I need some sleep. Okay, so the point I'm making is this is why, because of the Berlin Conference and the literal dividend up, the dividing, if you will, that basically brought that in and gave Europeans permission to not only go over there and take human bodies, but to decide what kind of clothes to wear, to decide what kind of food to cook, to decide what kind of words should be spoken and the language that they should be spoken in, and all of these things that came along with that. You have to understand that for almost 400 years of European intrusion, violence, and domination in Africa, the Berlin Conference served to provide a negotiation between European countries for which areas they would agree to confine their exploitative practices in Africa. And as I just said, they literally divided up the continent as if it were a slice of pizza, literally. Not to mention all the families that were victimized because of that. They didn't have to think about that. They didn't have to think about coming into someone else's space without being welcomed. They didn't have to think about how they weren't in a position to make those kind of demands or requests, because it was all about being supreme, and it was all about seeing the advantage, and it was all about seeing how Africa could be exploited, right? So we have to be very clear about that. And so I say all that to say, no one came to Senegal or Ghana or Ethiopia or Chad or Niger and asked permission. No, they just came in and decided what they wanted to take, how they wanted to take it, when they wanted to take it, and how often they would continue to take it. That's what happened. And so we think about that, and we think about how brutal and traumatizing that has been. We think about how for years and years and years after that, this is still the impact that we're facing with. This is still what's happening to us. If you are in a position where you're in an academic setting and you find yourself being critiqued by someone because they're telling you that you need to work on your writing and you have writing skills that need to be developed, part of that is because if you identify as an African person or if you are a colonized person, part of that is you don't speak the quote unquote colonizer's language. So part of the reason you're not writing quote unquote the way you should be writing, air quotes, is because that's not your language. So it makes sense that you're struggling with that. I have literally come to this epiphany within the last 6 years of being a graduate student. And now I tell anybody, I don't care how offensive you get when I say it, they, oh, screw, you need to work on your writing. Yes, well, I work at the writing center, but English is not my first language. So there we go, because I was colonized. And it's very awkward after that. It's not awkward for me though, because I'm speaking truth. I'm speaking facts. And we need to call it what it is. Let's call it what it is. And let's be honest about that. You have the nerve to critique me for not speaking the language that you want me to speak, but you didn't even teach it to me. And when my ancestors did try to learn it, you beat them and killed them for that. So how are we supposed to learn how to speak English properly when no one gave us the opportunity to learn how to do that? And what is properly too? Let's talk about that. But anyways, so this is what I'm saying to you all. This Berlin Conference has been abusing and terrorizing Africans for centuries and centuries and centuries to come. And we have to remember to think about that, especially when we think about the significance of African Liberation Day and how African Liberation Day is an opportunity for us to resist colonialization, for us to resist oppression, and for us to resist the narrative that we need to accept the fact that we are American, because we are not. Next slide, please. We also have to consider how the Universal Negro Improvement Association, which was founded by our comrade Marcus Garvey in 1915, grew to be between 3 to 6 million members with a publication. So you all have to remember and understand the UNIA, or the Universal Negro Improvement Association, was one of the main ways that messages were getting across to Africans across the world. They even were so organized, they were able to translate this newsletter into different languages. So they had a French version, they had a Spanish version, they had all these different languages because they understood, right? This idea of what the Berlin Conference had done. They understood that when we send messages to Jamaica, they need to be in this language versus we send messages to parts of Barbados, they need to be in this language. When we send messages to Cuba, let's make sure we print it in this language. So they understood that because they were trying to reach Africans everywhere. And they didn't want to be elitist and just send it out in English, because then the Africans that spoke Spanish or the Africans that spoke Portuguese wouldn't be able to understand what was needed to be said. And Marcus Garvey was trying very hard to help organize Africans everywhere, because he understood that Africans everywhere were oppressed. He literally traveled the world just as Kwame Nkrumah did. And he picked up on that just like Kwame Nkrumah did. So we understand that from learning from the UNIA, they were trying to reach 3 to 6 million members with their publication, The Negro World, because they were trying to help Africans understand with the help of The Negro World that there were some serious problems that lay ahead. And part of that was based on the fact that Africa itself was being attacked. And so because of it, Africans everywhere were suffering at the hands of that, because the continent was not being respected. So therefore, why would the people that come from that continent be respected just the same, right? And so we think about that, and we think about how the Negro World, Garvey's publication, or the UNIA's publication, I should say, was published, as I just said, in 33 different countries as well. And that was based on 1924. So not only was it in different languages, but it was published throughout the world in different countries, which again, was an opportunity for Africans to get access, for Africans to increase their political education, and for them to become more aware of what was happening, not just in their country, but around the world, right? So I talk to you all a lot of times about how in work study, we break it down and we have three sections of our meeting for work study. So we have our ideological section where we talk about the readings that we were assigned, and we try to answer discussion questions based on whoever is facilitating based on the readings. And of course, we try to tie it into the main idea of what the party's movement and slogan is, or the main idea of what we plan to do once we achieve a socialist Africa. And then when we are done with ideological, we move on to world geo, which is where we consider how events that are happening in the world play into us as organizers and us as members of work study, and how we can help advance the party's slogan based on understanding how activities and events that are happening in the world are shaping and impacting our ability to organize. That's one of my favorite parts of the meeting, even though I really love ideological. I love World Geo too, because World Geo gives us a chance to understand that we are not centering America in this, and we are not centering what happens to Africans in America in this conversation. We need to think about what's happening to Africans everywhere. We need to think about what's happening to indigenous people everywhere. We need to think about what's happening to Palestinian people everywhere, because everywhere that people are experiencing oppression, it is a threat to all of us. So that's why we enhance our political education, not only by reading new materials in ideological and discussing them, but we also enhance our political education by reading new materials in World Geo and discussing them as well. And the last section of the meeting is also my favorite. That's where we start to work on our personal organization with party affairs. So I say that to say, this is what Garvey understood. This is what the UNIA understood. And this is why they were trying to reach different folks everywhere, especially with different languages, because they understood that we needed to first get the message out to the Africans. And then we needed to make a plea that they needed to increase their political education. Let's talk about some things in the Negro world, and let's get people amped up and hyped up about it. And maybe, just maybe, they'll try to research some more so that they can follow up and get more information. And as you can imagine, many people did. Many people started donating to the UNIA. Many people started offering their services. If they didn't have money to donate, they offered their time because they knew how to type. They offered their proofreading skills. They offered their editing skills. They offered delivery services to get the actual publication to the physical place. This is what happens when you help people organize. And when you help people understand how they can contribute to a cause greater than themselves, then they start to put themselves at the rank of that, because they understand that they are in a vessel, but more than that, it's their responsibility, because the ancestors before them understood that. So you can't just be selfish now. You have to understand that there are still people to come after you. There are people who haven't even been conceived yet that are still going to come after you. And that's why you need to do your part to make sure that you can help make this world a better place. Part of that means helping Africans not be oppressed. That's what part of that means, which means helping Africa to become free. That's literally what that means. A plus B equals C. That's what that means. So we have to think about the UNIA slogan of up you mighty African. We think about that, up you mighty African, because the UNIA understood. We can't sit around, y'all. This is the time for sitting around. It's over. It's done with. We are under attack. And if you haven't figured that out by now, then I guess you're not willing to help us fight back. Because if you don't even see a problem, then you're not going to help us. So you can sit aside and we'll fight the cause for you. And then when you realize what we did for you, if you don't have your capitalist values anymore and your imperialist values anymore, then you can come with us when we find a way to free Africa. But you have to admit that there's a problem first and see what that looks like. So I close with encouraging you all to consider remembering your ancestors, to consider joining an organization that works for justice. Continue to think about our indigenous family and comrades. Continue to think about how this is their land. I proudly tell people everywhere I go, this is Cherokee land. This is not Memphis. This is Cherokee land. And they have renamed it Memphis, just like they renamed it South Africa when its name is Azania. Learn the old names. Do some research. Increase your political education. But don't do it alone. Start an organization where you can assign readings and talk about it with other people. You're never going to cause a movement and change the world by yourself. And you shouldn't have to. That's too much pressure. It would be better to do it with other people, because then you can share the labor and distribute it evenly. Last thing we want to do is take after the colonizer and assign laborious tasks to one particular person. Let's not take a page out of their book. Let's do it our own way. Join an organization working for justice. Alutua Continua.
Ashe, 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 ashe. Thank you very much, Shakura. And we're going to continue on by laying the foundation for what African Liberation Day is, what it means, what its significance is, and why it's important today in 2022 and beyond. So Shakura talked about some of the early Pan-African work, right? The development of the Universal Negro Improvement Association and their impact worldwide, as well as the early Pan-African Congress meetings that took place at the initiation of Anna Julia Cooper, whose picture you saw, Henry Sylvester Williams, whose picture you saw, W.B. Du Bois, whose picture you saw. And those meetings took place, the first four meetings took place between 1900, the first one being a conference, and then they moved to the first Congress meeting and going up through 1927. Now, the difference between a conference and a Congress. Well, a conference, you know, if you've gone to a conference before, you know what that is. You go there, there's people presenting information. You sit there with people, you might, maybe it's a week-long conference. You talk to them during that week, maybe even you go afterwards and grab food together, maybe drinks or whatever. And then after that conference is together, you may or may not ever see those people ever again. A Congress is different in the sense that a Congress, you don't just share information, you certainly do that, but you share information based on a common objective and you have tasks assigned. And so when you have your first Congress meeting and you're making an assessment of where you are and where you want to go, and if you didn't get there, why not? What you need to do differently and what your positions are. You evaluate what your positions are and you struggle over them and you update them and you have them evolve. These are all the things that happen in a Congress process. So with a Congress, you just don't come and share information and then go your separate ways. You are going to meet again for the next Congress after the first one, and you're going to evaluate what you determined during that first Congress. What were the ideas that you decided you wanted to stand for? And how do those ideas sound for you now that you've had an opportunity to work with them and work with people around them? And if there needs to be adjustments, you know, what are those adjustments? How would you make them? And what is the assessment of your work overall? How successful were you in achieving your objectives? What changes need to take place to better improve your work? These are all the things that take place during a Congress process. So as I mentioned, we had the first four Pan-African Congresses between 1900, the first one being a conference and then a Congress, and then up through 1927. The fifth Pan-African Congress took place in 1945. And held in Manchester, England. That Congress was really the defining note for the Pan-African Congresses, because unlike the first four, which were great and very important foundation building meetings, they were primarily intellectual and dominantly attended by Africans who were not on the African continent. The fifth Pan-African Congress changed that. It had a very large contingent of workers, of trade unionists, who were at the fifth Pan-African Congress in 1945. It had representatives from all over the world still, but the dominant number of people came from throughout the African continent to participate in the fifth Pan-African Congress. So this was a leap forward. And it was also at that meeting where the concept of one unified socialist Africa was first discussed. It was first discussed as an objective that made sense for all of Africa to work towards and achieve. And Kwame Nkrumah, of course, that great son of Africa who was the first president of Ghana, a mere 12 years after this fifth Pan-African Congress, had been working. You know, that's the thing that's important to note, is that you don't get to the point of being a leader by just showing up and people elect you and you're the leader. This man was working all through the decades, working through the 40s. He was the convener of the fifth Pan-African Congress in 1945. He was the facilitator of that. And because he had a vision for our future as African people, he was able to bring in an aging W.E.B. Du Bois, bring in Amy Jock Garvey, who along with Amy Ashwood Garvey, as Shakur mentioned, and Marcus Garvey were the founders of the UNIA, the Universal Negro Improvement Association. He was able to bring in both of them, Amy Jock Garvey and W.E.B. Du Bois, as a symbolic effort, because at that time, a lot of people, and a lot of people still today, believe it or not, are still focused on this dispute between Du Bois and Garvey. So this was Nkrumah's strategic effort to say that we are all united and we are in this together. I have the widow of Marcus Garvey, because of course he had passed away 5 years before the fifth Pan-African Congress, and I have W.E.B. Du Bois. And so we're here to squash all that. We're here to build unity among African people and move forward. So that was a defining moment. One unified socialist Africa, and the need and the call for everybody at the fifth Pan-African Congress to go back to their respective areas and to organize mass political parties that would carry out the struggle in Africa, because in 1945, all of Africa was colonized, right? And so to create mass political parties to carry out that work, not vanguard parties. We respect vanguard parties. We respect the Marxist-Leninist model, the Maoist model, all of those models, the Trotskyist model. Those are great for other people. But for African people, for Pan-Africanists, our culture is a mass culture. We're a mass people. We're a collective people. That's why we don't just live with our mother, father, and siblings. We have grandparents and aunts and uncles. And most of us think we do that just for economics, but that's a part of our culture. We're a collective people. We address life through a collective process. Capitalism wants to convince us that the individualistic approach is the correct way, but that's why it doesn't work. Every time we try it, it doesn't work, because we are a collective people by culture. No matter where we're born or where we live, that doesn't change that. So we made the call at the fifth Pan-African Congress for the construction of mass parties. And people who attended that went back to their respective areas and they began to organize mass parties. In Ghana, it ended up being the Convention People's Party, a mass party. In Kenya, it was the Tanzanian African National Union, which was a mass organization. The Kenyan African National Union. In Tanzania, it was the Tanzanian African National Union. In Azania, organizations had existed, like the African National Congress existed, but the Fifth Pan-African Congress helped support and intensify that effort. And the African National Congress and the Pan-Africanist Congress of Azania and all of these organizations began to develop as we moved into the 1950s. The Azanian People's Organization in Azania, all of these organizations began to develop. The African Party for the Independence of Guinea-Bissau was developed as a result of this fervor for mass political organizations. The National Congolese Movement in the Congo was developed as a part of this fervor. Sekou Touré was one of those trade unionists who participated in the 5th Pan-African Congress. Like my father, he was a postal worker, and he went back to Guinea and began work, and that ended up being the Democratic Party of Guinea, another mass Pan-Africanist political party. So this was what the 5th Pan-African Congress, or the 5th PAC as we call it, gave us, was the mass political party structure that served as the impetus to bring about the independence movement in Africa. And that's important because that movement was the first step towards moving us to where we are today. And not only was it the first step in Africa to eliminate colonialism in Africa, but it also influenced the African liberation movement all over the world. If you read the writings of Huey P. Newton, the co-founder and minister of defense for the Black Panther Party, right? He talked about how he was influenced by the Land and Freedom Movement, the Mau Mau Movement in Kenya. That was one of the movements. Malcolm X talked often about the Land and Freedom Movement, the Mau Mau Movement. So the independence movements, and you see the picture there on your screen, you see the picture on the middle left of Kwame Nkrumah and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Kwame Nkrumah invited Dr. King to Ghana's independence ceremony in March of 1957. And Martin Luther King wrote often about how this influenced him and helped him understand the importance of dignity and standing up as an African man to fight for our liberation. This was one of his primary motivations. He wrote about it in several of his books. So this is important to understand because this 5th Pan-African Congress, or 5th PAC, the African Independence Movement, it influenced the African movement for justice all around the world. And we see, you know, several pictures on the screen that illustrate that, from Malcolm X with Kwame Nkrumah in Harlem in the middle, to Sister Theodora Gomes on the bottom right, who is still active and alive organizer in the PAIGC in Guinea-Bissau, and UDAMU, the General Union of Guinea-Bissau Women in UDAMU, and has been a keynote speaker at our African Liberation Day program the last 2 years, and was involved in the liberation anti-colonial war against Portugal, and took up arms. That sister took up arms and fought in that war against Portugal as a very young woman, and is still active and is still one of the mothers of our Pan-African struggle on earth. So all of this was influenced from all of the things that Shakur talked about and what I've talked about on this page. And we keep going and we talk about how we're able to have our ability to have African Liberation Day as our freedom tool today. From all this work we've just gotten through discussing with you, African Liberation Day has emerged as a freedom day for us. The actual day started on April 15th, 1958. That's a mistake there on the screen. I apologize. 1958 was the first initiation of Africa Freedom Day, and it started in Ghana during the Conference of Independent African States in 1958. And the call was for Africa Freedom Day because, again, Kwame Nkrumah, who at that time was the president of Ghana through the Convention People's Party, understood, as he said during his Independence Day speech on March 6, 1957, that Ghana's independence means nothing without the total liberation of Africa. Again, all of this evolving from that Pan-African Congress process. And so once Africa Freedom Day was declared in 1963, when Nkrumah, along with other African leaders that he was trying to work with at the time, like Haile Selassie in Ethiopia, they formed the Organization of African Unity, or the OAU, which today is the African Union. And they had the founding conference in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, in 1963. And it was there that Africa Freedom Day was changed from that name to African Liberation Day. And it was purported as a symbol to the liberation of Africa, the freedom and liberation of the African continent. But at that time, neocolonialism, which we'll talk about, was basically a new concept. And Kwame Nkrumah and no one else understood the role and the impact neocolonialism would have in creating obstacles for the type of African liberation that we need. But nonetheless, it's important to note that African Liberation Day, or ALD as we call it, came to exist as a result of the work coming from the Pan-African Congresses, particularly that fifth Pan-African Congress, and all of the people that worked to bring about African unity as a result of that. And the concept is that when we say Pan-Africanism or one unified socialist Africa, the concept is that it doesn't matter that we have thousands of languages and we speak different languages. It doesn't matter that we live in 120 countries worldwide. It doesn't matter that we practice so many different religions, that we eat so many different foods, that we listen to such different music, that we totally have different ways of life. All of those things don't matter at the end of the day, because Kwame Nkrumah was absolutely 100% correct when he said our similarities outweigh our differences. Yes, those are all of our differences. But even with all of those differences, we still have a common history and a common culture. And that common history is that we have been colonized and denied our birthright to have the ability to determine our own lives. No matter what language you speak, African, you have been violated through what I just described. No matter what religion you practice, you have been violated by this process of colonialism and slavery. No matter where you live on earth, you have been violated because of this process of colonialism and slavery. In fact, where you live is a direct result of colonialism and slavery. If you're African and you're going to school or living somewhere in Europe or Canada or anywhere else, that's because of colonialism. Because whatever you went to Europe and Canada or the US to get, you should have been able to get that in Africa. And the reason why you don't have that in Africa is because of colonialism. So that is the reason why you're all over the world. And certainly those of us who were born in this cesspool country, we're only here because of colonialism and slavery. That is the only reason why we're here in the Western Hemisphere and speaking English. Some of us are confused. We think, well, I'm here because, you know, I was just fly. I wanted to have an adventure. I struck out on my own. I got my own boat. And I paid Christopher Columbus a fee and I rode over here and I just decided I liked it. So I decided to stay. Some of us are confused and believe nonsense like that. But the truth is irrefutably that we were kidnapped, screaming, hollering and jerking around, kidnapped and forced here in the holds of ships, chained together with other Africans, people that spoke those different languages, that practiced those different religions. And despite all that, we still unified to engage in slave revolts, to overthrow the master. We still figured out how to communicate, even though we didn't speak the same language. We didn't practice the same religion. We didn't eat the same foods. We didn't come from the same place. We still unified. So when we talk about African Liberation Day in 2022 and beyond, we don't want to hear nothing about, well, they speak English and we speak French and they speak Portuguese. That has nothing to do with the fact, irrefutable, that until Africa is free, we'll never be free. So if we speak those different languages, if we're from these different places, we better figure out a way to address that, just like we did on the slave ships, just like we did in the colonies, to come together so that we can win this fight. And you know what? It's not a theory that we can do that. We're already doing it. That's the work that the All African People's Revolutionary Party is engaged in and has been engaged in for 50 years and will continue to be engaged in until we have victory. We have people in the party who speak all sorts of languages. Oftentimes, we have people on committees together and meetings together that don't speak the same language. We are human beings. And as Sekou Touré said, there is nothing human beings cannot do. So we figure those problems out. It takes time, but we got nothing but time because we're oppressed. And until we figure these problems out, we're going to continue to be oppressed. So all we have to do is sit down and figure out ways to address these problems so that we can unify, come together, defeat this enemy, and have forward progress for all of our people and all of humanity for the rest of the time that the earth exists. And so we're saying that because African Liberation Day is our institution and our symbol for all these things I just got through talking about. And not only for African liberation, but as it says there, uplifting other liberation movements, non-African movements, and understanding that when they win, we win. So we should support them because they're fighting the same enemies that we're fighting. The Palestinian people fighting for their land back in Palestine are fighting the same enemies that colonize and oppress us. The indigenous people of the Western Hemisphere in getting this land back are fighting the same enemies that we're fighting, that colonize and oppress us. The only way that the indigenous people can get their land back is by us being able to get our land back in Africa. All of that has to happen. There's no way indigenous people can get this land back as long as we're still oppressed and exploited, and Africa's in the situation it's in. There's no way Africa can be free as long as the indigenous people are colonized and oppressed here and unable to get their land back. So only an absolute idiot would not understand that as an African, it makes sense for you from a practical point of view to say, I support the indigenous people getting their land back. And only an insane indigenous person would not understand that it's important for them to see the necessity for Africa to be free. And only an absolutely ignorant Palestinian could not see that the indigenous people getting these lands back and us getting Africa back and the Irish getting Ireland back, all of that does nothing but ensure the success for all of us and all of humanity. So that's what African Liberation Day is all about, you all. Those are the values that I just articulated that it represents, and that's what it means. And so just to break some of that down just a little teeny bit further, we'll just talk about, for example, African Liberation Day 2022, because we use this as an institution. Every year, we use African Liberation Day. It's our institution. What do we mean when we say that? Well, when you have a mass of people, millions of people, institutions are propaganda mechanisms that are used to inform the people about specific ideas and actions that are designed to help the people understand why they should hopefully embrace those ideas and actions. So capitalism and imperialism, the enemies of humanity, they have plenty of institutions that are designed to do that. And you know they do because we have all been conditioned to participate in their institutions. Miss Christ, or what they call Christmas, that's one of their institutions. I know I believe in Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And yeah, I get that, but you don't control the propaganda around Christianity. There's no way you do, because they got you convinced that you need to be more concerned with who's sleeping with who than poverty and oppression on the planet Earth. That type of backward analysis does nothing except benefit the ruling capitalist classes. Because when people are thinking it like that on that small ladder rung level, then you're not thinking about why do these people control all the wealth on earth and we have nothing. And all you're thinking about is, well, this person's sleeping with this person. That is so insignificant. And to be honest, and I'll say this, I hope it does offend you when I say it, if you believe this nonsense. Any God that's concerned about who's sleeping with who and is not concerned about the injustices perpetuated against millions of people, millions of children murdered because of this oppressive dominance of the earth, and you're talking to me about a God that ain't got nothing to say or do about that, but is concerned about who's sleeping with who, then I say to hell with you and your God. And send me straight to hell. I don't want nothing to do with no so-called God that has that kind of backward framework. And if that offends you, then you're part of the problem. If that offends anybody, you're part of the problem, because that is not the type of mentality that is going to move us forward. That is a reflection of their institution of Christianity to be used to promote colonialism and exploitation and the theft of land and the enslavement of people and the continued domination of everybody's resources. That's what that's their institution. That's what they use Christmas for, to promote them, the institutionalization of their stuff. That's why the primary value in their version of Christmas is buying stuff, because that's the fundamental principle in capitalism, buying stuff for people, making sure you spend money you don't have. And if you don't have money to buy stuff for people, you should feel bad, you're a loser. If you don't have anybody around you, you should feel bad, you're a loser. Veterans Day, that's one of their institutions. They actually want to convince you. I was talking to someone the other day, and he told me just Thursday, and he told me, he's a guy on the street, said, you know, problems. And he said, you know, I fought for you. I fought for this country. And I told him, you didn't fight for me. You didn't fight for this country, really. He was in Vietnam. I said, so explain to me, I grew up in inner city in San Francisco, living hell. So explain to me how you going to a war in Vietnam was for me, and how that contributed to my life. Please explain. He couldn't do it, because it's not possible to do that, because that doesn't make any sense. I said, you didn't fight for me or this country. You fought for multinational corporations. They pimped you. They used you. That's what happened. I'm not saying that to say you're a bad person, but you have to face the truth. That's the truth. You were pimped. You were holed by this system. We're all pimped and holed by this system. So it's not any kind of, even in the recovery classes, they tell you the first thing you got to do is acknowledge the problem. So we got to acknowledge the problem. We're all prostitutes for the capitalist system, whether we have a job and a W-2, whether we own a business, whatever you do, you're being pimped by this system. So that's what I told the guy. And he couldn't disagree. He said, well, that's true. I said, if it wasn't true, you wouldn't be out here on the streets. If you fought for this country, you wouldn't be out here on the streets. So you need to deal with that, and that'll help you deal with the problem of being on the streets. Face reality. I'll help you do it, but I'm not going to help you if you're not going to deal with the truth. So African Liberation Day is our institution to combat all that backward foolishness and to come with some truth. And the truth is that until we unite, we will never be free. And we have to unite against this system. We can't just unite in our heads. We can't fight a fight just in our heads. We have to confront the capitalist imperialist system. And that's what African Liberation Day is designed to do. So that's why our theme this year, you all, 2022, is preparing for a leap forward to worldwide Pan-African unity. Neo-colonialism must be dismantled. And again, think of African Liberation Day as our propaganda institution designed to reach millions of African people all over the world to help us understand the necessity to get engaged and wage this fight, right? And to influence our principles and our action. That's what it's designed to do. And then understanding neocolonialism, because neocolonialism is mentioned in the theme. And neocolonialism is a system where the colonizing countries, Britain, France, Belgium, Germany, Shakur talked about them, right? Spain, the US, all of these countries today, Canada, Zionist Israel, all of the colonizing countries, they leave the colonies, so they're no longer physically there. Like the Mau Mau happened in Kenya, so the British had to leave. The people wanted independence, the British had to leave. But the entire apparatus in the country was set up and designed to benefit Britain. In Ghana, they talked about how the entire civil service was trained by the British. The military was trained by the British. All the values that the people had were British values. And that means the people felt like when they acted in the interests of Britain, they were acting in their own interests. And so this is a colonial mindset. So even though the British are no longer in Ghana, no longer in Kenya, the people in Ghana think like the British. The people in Kenya think like the British, so they therefore act like the British. even though the French are no longer in Senegal or Cameroons or Mali, the people in Senegal, Cameroons, or Mali think like the French. Therefore, they act in the interest of the French. The people in Haiti are, the effort is to make them act in the interest of France. The Africans in the US, the effort is to make us act in the interest of this backward capitalist country. So that's why they want you to think that you're American, because even though they're not in your house, they control the values, the ideas that exist in your house. They don't have to be physically in your house if they control the ideas and the values that exist in your house, because if they know that if they control the ideas and the values that exist in your house, then they'll control the actions that come out of your house. They understand that clearly, even if we don't, they are not confused about that. And so that is the issue that we want to address. That's what neocolonialism is. They're no longer present, but they control the entire apparatus. And the way neocolonialism works in Africa today is you get a neocolonial puppet leader and you put him in the position of power. You give him military support to keep him in power. You give him weapons and training to keep him in power. And you exploit the resources. You come in, steal all the diamonds, gold, coltan, uranium, bauxite, cocoa, whatever it is, steel, zinc, whatever it is. And his job is to ensure that you have access to all of those resources as cheaply as possible, as consistently as possible. And his reward for ensuring you get that is to, he gets riches, he becomes rich, he's comfortable, his family's comfortable, while the masses of people suffer and receive nothing. Receive nothing. That's how neocolonialism works. And a lot of us are fooled by that, even in 2022, because we'll look at it and we'll say, well, that's a black president. That's progress. Like Barack Obama, that's progress. We've made progress. We've got a black president. But as Immortal Technique raps in the song, it doesn't make any difference because the only candidate that's acceptable is the one America finds electable. So, or I'm sorry, the only candidate that's electable is the one America finds acceptable, pardon me. So that's the reality. So, you know, I always joke, they'll have a transgender one-eyed Martian can be president of this backward capitalist country as long as that transgender one-eyed Martian supports capitalism, white supremacy, patriarchy, homophobia, that person can be president of the capitalist empire. And not just the US, all of them, Britain, France, all of that's true. That's true. You may have to do a little work to get people to overcome a little, you know, confusion that you gave them in the first place, but they'll do that because, like Malcolm X said, during World War II, they made everybody on earth through their propaganda hate Germany and love Russia, love the Soviet Union, right? And then after World War II, they made everybody love Russia and hate the Soviet Union. So they can make you think whatever they want you to think. They have the strong propaganda mechanisms to do that. They just work on you over time, and they know we don't do our own research. So they slowly begin to have inroads into our thinking. And before you know it, what's coming out of our mouth are all of their talking points. So that's what neocolonialism is. And it's an insidious system. That's why we need to organize and defeat it. And so, you know, it's important just to understand when we talk about African Liberation Day, why we're so excited about it. For me, it's the only holiday I celebrate because I don't celebrate any of their reactionary capitalist holidays. Don't do it. Haven't done it since I was a teenager. You know, Shakura was never raised celebrating Christmas or Thanksgiving or Fourth of July. She never celebrated any of that stuff from us her whole life. And so we tried to raise her with different values, revolutionary Pan-Africanist values. And so for me, African Liberation Day is exciting for me. This will be my 38th one as a member of the All African People's Revolutionary Party. And I'm as excited as a child getting toys. The night before African Liberation Day, the first night in 1984 that I participated, I couldn't sleep. I was so excited. Last year, my 37th year, the night before the program, I couldn't sleep. I was so excited. Why am I excited? Because I don't know about you, but the concept of African people all over the world speaking different languages, coming together under one theme with one message that we have to unite and fight against these enemies and overcome them so that we can win and do something for our people and for humanity. I don't know about you, but that concept is extremely exciting to me. It is so exciting that the symbolism of it keeps me up the night before. So I'm looking forward to later this month, not being able to sleep again that night before. It's an annual tradition for me to get up. And what I did last year is I got up, I watched speeches, I watched videos of past African Liberation Days from Washington, D.C., from Guyana. I watched the one we did 31 years ago here in Sacramento where Tupac rapped, and I have that video on YouTube. I watched that and it just inspires me. I remember all the years, all the struggles, all the work that I've had the honor to participate in. And it's just inspirational, because what that does for me is it helps me remember they can't defeat us. They can't stop us from achieving this. There's nothing they can do to stop us from achieving that. And I just have, it just gives me a strength of continuing on and fighting and giving it my best to make the best contribution I can make. And that just makes me feel like I've earned my place. I've earned what the ancestors put me here to do. And that's what African Liberation Day means for me. You'll never have that type of feeling from unwrapping a Christmas present, I guarantee you. You'll never get that type of feeling from eating turkey on Thanksgiving. You'll never get that feeling from fireworks on the 4th of July. You'll never get that feeling on Veterans Day or any of these backward reactionary capitalist holidays they want you to commemorate here. You'll never get any of that. All of those combined can't give you that. The only thing that can give you that is the type of dignity that you get from from institutions like African Liberation Day. So we want to say that you should share our excitement for the same reasons that I indicated that I get excited, because this is a day that represents a new dawn for humanity. It symbolizes a new dawn for humanity. It represents a new way of life that we can create for ourselves. Now, some people just like to sit around and justify why things are the way they are and how they can't do anything about it. And if you're that type of person or you know somebody like that, that's your personal problem. I don't understand that. To me, I feel like my reason for being on the earth is not to explain why things are jacked up, but to figure out how to change it. And even if I can't change it myself, to do work that'll further the process so that the generations coming after me will have it that much easier to find that solution. That's what I see my role. I don't even want to sit down and talk with people who talk about what we can't do. I don't even speak that language about what we can't do. I don't even understand that when people are talking about what cannot happen. I don't even understand how you could allow yourself to let somebody convince you that something cannot happen. I don't even speak that language. When people start talking about that, I disconnect. Like, I don't want to hear that. People talking about what we can't do. We can do anything. There's nothing we cannot do. There's nothing you cannot do. No, why would you let somebody convince you that there's limits and there's stuff you can't do? I don't even want to hear that. I can do whatever we need to do. And I know you can too, because I'm not any better than you. So that's what African Liberation Day represents for me, those values. And that's why you should embrace it, because it'll do the same thing for you. Because unlike these backward capitalist institutions, it's not designed to tear you down and make you wonder why you're not able to do all these money things. It's designed to take the best within you and build it up, lift it up. That's what it's designed to do. So we want you to participate with us this year in African Liberation Day. We want you to put it on your calendar and participate with us for African Liberation Day 2022. We'll be back next week. We're broadcasting on our new page, Our Ancestors' Voices on Facebook, still on YouTube, Twitter. We've worked out all the technical problems, so we should have no issue being here. And we look forward to next week. Please let people know. We're going to be talking about African Liberation Day every week this month before the event. Next week, we're going to talk about African Liberation Day and Malcolm X, and talk about Malcolm X's evolving Pan-Africanist consciousness and how all of that is tied into all of the values we've talked about today with African Liberation Day, and why we should understand that about Malcolm's journey that this backward government knew he was on. That's why they stopped him from being able to continue. So that's what we're going to talk about. So please let people know. You know, go to Twitter, go to our pages there, and you can find out, or YouTube, or again on Facebook. You can get the link from betterworld.me if you want to be on Zoom. Go to our Forward Ever shop and get you some of these clothes. We need the money. We got African Liberation Day commemorations in Africa, and we need the money. So please go buy something. You want to have some positive propaganda that you're wearing, so go ahead and buy that. You can get it. They're all, go to the page. There's several different clothing items you can buy. So check it out. I'm just modeling the one there. I know I'm not the best model, but you don't have to base it on me. Go ahead and get you some of them fly fits. And then go to aprp-intl.org. Find out more about our party. Join the All African People's Revolutionary Party. I mentioned abetterworld.me. You can go there to see all of these videos. You can go there to make a donation for African Liberation Day. I just went and Venmoed the money to our Central Administration Committee, $150 in donations that you all made to support our African Liberation Days on the ground. So go on to abetterworld.me and make a donation. $5, $10, you don't have to donate a lot. Whatever you got is going home to Africa. It's an investment in Africa. Hoodcommunist.org, our bi-monthly Telegram event is coming up. You want to look forward to that. Every Thursday, we have new articles. I'm one of the editors, and we want you to definitely support these revolutionary African voices. We want you to take selfies. African Liberation Day is May 24th and 25th. 24th, we're going to have a program of panels, international panels, talking about the theme that's there on the flyer, preparing for a leap forward to worldwide Pan-African unity. Neo-colonialism must be dismantled. So we'll have representatives from liberation movements talking about that. And then on May 25th, we're going to live stream the African Liberation Day march and rally from Guinea-Bissau, West Africa, sponsored by the African Party for the Independence of Guinea-Bissau, the PAIGC, the party of Amilcar Cabral. That is one of our sibling pan-revolutionary pan-African parties. So we want you to participate in that. We're organizing an African Liberation Day party here. People come over, have food, and watch the programs. So do that. It's a good thing to do. Organize your lives around positive institutions. All of our broadcasts are on the bottom of the screen there. Pontula, Revolutionary African Women, Forward Ever Broadcast, APRP New Mexico News, Pan-African News on Thursdays at noon Mountain Time. So support all of these independent revolutionary Pan-African voices. We get sick of people, well, I support Black lives, and you don't even know nothing about the Pan-African movement. That's our movement on an international level. That's our movement on an international level. So stop saying you support our lives and you don't know anything about what we're doing. You don't not doing anything to support our work, then you don't support us. So, and that's okay if you don't support us, we don't need you. But I'm saying, stop saying that. You're not fooling us when you say it. So continue to buy my book, A Guide for Organizing Defense Against White Supremacist, Patriarchal, and Fascist Violence. We're meeting all over the country. I'm meeting with groups. We have trainings here in Sacramento. Get the book, get involved. It's not something you'll regret. The alarm is going off. Our time is up. We appreciate each and every one of you. We want to wish you a wonderful rest of your Sunday afternoon. We hope you will join us next week. One unified socialist Africa, Forward Ever. Patriarchy is evil. We're going to crush it. Capitalism is evil. We're going to crush it. White supremacy, you already know, it's got to go. I hope you all enjoy the rest of your Sunday.